Hey guys, thanks for tuning in to Making It Work. I'm Jimmy. If you haven't been here before, I appreciate you watching my channel. This video today is going to be about the manufacturer's labor times and how mechanics tend to always come up on the losing end when they pick times out of the sky for us to service their vehicles. Let's go ahead and get into this video. One of the biggest problems is manufacturers seem to be able to just pick times out of the sky for us to service their vehicles. I'm not sure if they actually do like a controlled environment circumstances where they do repairs on a vehicle to calculate the time, and then they subtract 30 or 40% or how that works, but it always seems like we come out on a losing end. And the past 6 to 8 years, it's gotten worse and worse and worse, especially the past few years. But something's got to be done, because mechanics, especially in dealerships, that's where it starts. And then it trickles down to the rest of the industry, because the rest of the industry bases their times on the dealerships. Manufacturers actually set those times. And then the aftermarket tends to cushion those times slightly, because the cars aren't as new and they're not under warranty anymore. So what they're doing is they're just getting these times, even if it is in a controlled environment where everything's perfect, the tools are ready to go, the car is in a bay, they already have the parts they need, and they're gonna do that repair. They're not dealing with older cars, they're not dealing with oil leaks, they're not dealing with dirt and road grime, they're not dealing with getting the wrong part or defective part. And sometimes the real world, the engine's hot or it's freezing cold, and the repair might call for the engine being slightly warm before you start tearing it down. So whatever these real world times are, you and I both know, whatever they're doing doesn't seem quite right. You have to really pull teeth to try to get a little bit of extra time. And a lot of these jobs, especially it seems like on most of the Asian cars, if you get an Asian job, whether it's a condenser or evaporator or whatever it may be, if it pays 3.5 hours labor, you know you're in for a real treat. It's going to be a big job, because the Asian car manufacturers don't give up labor time too easily. So it seems like that's the uphill battle. If it pays 0.8, it'll probably take you about that, you know, like an alternator or something. It'll take you 7/10 or 8/10 of an hour to do. By the time you gotta figure in looking at the car, finding out what it needs, putting in the part, road testing the vehicle, verifying the repair, all of those things, that adds time. And most of those jobs that pay 0.6 or 0.8 for an alternator, or whatever the case may be, even if something like a belt, you can't just pop a belt on a car without checking all the other pulleys and bearings, right? But my point is that their labor times don't seem terribly accurate. And what they're doing is they're pulling down their labor times so they can claim a lower cost of ownership and pay the technicians at their dealerships less. Now, everyone at the dealerships and everyone in the aftermarket industry, they all know that they're getting shortchanged on warranty times and even regular labor times. They tend to be inaccurate for the most part. Once in a while, you'll find a job that pays a little bit more than it takes, which it's like when a rose grows in a field of weeds, all of a sudden you get this one job that you're like, whoa, that only took me half an hour and it pays 1.3, which is not very common. That's where the roses grow in the weeds. But what we need to do is we need to form some kind of mechanics alliance, because everyone's pushing for higher wages and $15 an hour minimum wage. Mechanics aren't organizing to get their due, and mechanics are severely shortchanged, I think. Even the mechanics making a good living, they're not doing it because they're being paid so well. They're doing it because they're hustling. You know, they're working 6 days a week, 10, 12-hour days, sometimes more. Especially in my younger days, that's what I used to do all the time. Now that I've gotten a little older, I'm not able to do it. I'm just wore out after a 10-hour day. I'm wore out. You know, making YouTube videos and doing my mechanic job, it's probably about a 75-80-hour week. And it's tiring. I actually like making the YouTube videos quite a bit. It taps into my creative side, and I really enjoy that part. So it helps get me through it. But I'm tired. I'm sleeping really good. So the bottom line is, what are we going to do to try to get mechanics paid a little bit better? We can try to form some kind of an alliance, like I was saying, that maybe a mechanics group. You probably couldn't do it on Facebook or some of these other places. That they would probably shut it down if powerful people get wind of it. To try to shut it down, it's almost like trying to form a union in a non-union company. It's not an easy thing to do, but we need to do something. Think that mechanics, on a whole, the tools you have to buy, I don't know what other profession you can tell me where the mechanics buy most of their own tools, a large majority of their own tools, you know, and they replace tools when they break. They have to buy more tools when new tools come out. And the manufacturers, not only do they cut the labor times back, but they seem to obsolete out the fasteners so that you have to buy more tools all the time. So to me, if a shop's not buying 100% of your tools, or the manufacturer, the dealership's not buying 100% of your tools, you should be properly compensated in your paycheck to cover all those tool expenses. I want to do something for mechanics out there that we can form some kind of an alliance. I mean, guys, give me some ideas. Tell me what you think we can do. Because if we stick together, there's power in numbers, you know? If you just sit back and take it, and you know, you're working really hard and you're barely making $50,000 a year right now, that's nothing. I mean, I was making $50,000 in the 90s. So with the cost of living, now gas is up to $3 a gallon plus in a lot of places, especially if you use super unleaded. You know, the price of, you can't get a Happy Meal at McDonald's for less than $9 or $10 anymore. I got a Subway combo meal the other day. It was like $11.50. That used to be $5 and change, $6 and change. So the price of everything's gone up, but the paychecks aren't keeping up with it, and we need to do something about it. So I'm open for suggestions. That's why I made this video. If you guys want to put something down in the comments below, click like, subscribe. Let's get involved. Let's see what we can do to try to make things better for mechanics. Because what they're doing right now, they're only doing because they can. They can basically do whatever they want, and we're just happy to have a job and have work and try to make some money. And the guys that really hustle might be approaching a six-figure mark, but they're probably also spending, you know, $10,000, $15,000 a year on tools, keeping up with scanners and programming and all those things. Obviously, at the dealership, they're going to cover some of that, and they tend to also pay a little less because you're making warranty time. So even though the dealership will buy your scanner, they're going to pay you 0.4 for doing a programming and update on a car, that you have to go find the car, pull it in, verify the concern, service bulletin or recall, whatever it may be. You have to do the programming update. Then you have to document it. You have to put a sticker on the car saying that a recall was completed. You know, you may need to get parts, or you may need to call tech support and all those kinds of things. And I've seen the labor times in the dealership for some of that work. It pays like 0.4, 0.7, 0.8. You know, if you're really lucky, it pays a full hour. And it probably takes an hour and a half, you know. I don't think you can do, find a car, bring it in, do the programming, road test it to reset idle learn and all those things. Sometimes you got to do key fobs. You can't, there's no way anybody can do that in less than a half an hour if they're doing it correctly. So, you know, why would it pay 0.4 and put you behind the eight ball where you have to work 70 hours a week to make 55 or 60 hours a week? And they'll say, well, you're making a good paycheck. No, I should be paid for the time I spent on that car. And I should have a cushion. That's what flat rate is. Flat rate means you get paid $30 an hour, and you can you want to be 20 or 30% ahead of your clock hours with your flagged hours or your flat rate pay hours. That's the goal for most good mechanics, to be at least 20 or 30% ahead of their clock hours. So a 40-hour week, you want to do 50 hours, and if you work 50 hours on the clock, you want 65 hours. You know, 60 something hours is a good week. You know, where I work, if you get 42 hours, they tend to think that that's a pretty good week. But in reality, that's just barely acceptable because it's equal to the clock hours or actually just slightly under. So just some random thoughts I wanted to make a quick video about. And I want you guys to participate. Go down in the comments and tell me what you think we can do to try to make things more fair for mechanics and try to hurt the industry is being crippled right now by a mechanic shortage. People hardly want to work as it is. And they definitely don't want to be mechanics out in the heat and having to buy tens of thousands of dollars or even hundreds of thousands of dollars worth of tools to do it. To work out in the heat, work on hot cars. You know, people are generally frustrated, their car's broken down. So there's all kinds of reasons that things could turn negative and that our industry could be adversely affected, you know, a few years down the road, especially with the advent of electric cars and technology, where things are going to get more complicated. So just some thoughts for today, guys. Let me know what you think. I appreciate you watching this video. Thanks for watching this video, guys. See you in the next one.